So, good afternoon, everyone. Today we have Randy Johnson here from South Dakota State. He's in the process of finishing his master's, and what he studied is what our topic of the talk today is. He studied mountain lions in the North Dakota Badlands for close to 2 years and more. He's right now finishing up, writing his thesis and wrapping up, looking for the next step in his life. The way I know him since back in 2012. That's when he was a graduate. He was an undergraduate student at South Dakota State, and then he joined his master's project, and now he's done and heading out. So again, I'm very proud of him, and we all wish him all the best in his next pursuit. So with that, I'll let him take over and give his talk on mountain lions in North Dakota.
Okay, perfect. Well, thanks everybody for being here. It's cool to come and give a talk, and it's nice to have people interested in what you're studying. Hopefully everybody can see that okay. So we'll just get started. I covered a lot of aspects with my research. The two main ones are wrapped up in population dynamics and habitat use. So a little bit of an overview of what I'm going to talk about. Just go through, can everybody hear me okay? I should say too, if you have questions along the way, just raise your hand. I mean, informal is good with me. Talk about the history of lions in North Dakota, and then kind of a summary of what I did. Again, it's a summary. I won't go into too much detail about the statistics and all those fun things. Focus more on results. And then I've got a few slides at the end to kind of talk about recreating in lion country. What to do when you're out there, how to act, how not to have a negative encounter, essentially. So with that, some history. Mountain lions are native to North Dakota. They were here historically, primarily out west in the rugged parts of the state. But out east, they did occur, you know, usually along the riparian zones, the river habitat, those types of things. You know, out in the wide open plains, they were rare then too. By the turn of the 20th century or so, mountain lions had pretty much been extirpated from the state. They were wiped away for various reasons, mainly human persecution. A few decades passed with no mountain lions, or at least very, very, very few. And then during the 1960s, most of the western states kind of changed their approach to mountain lions. They changed them from being on a bounty program, you know, paid to kill them. They changed it to game species. They put closed seasons on them, these types of things. And what it did was it allowed these populations to rebound a little bit, to increase. And as they increased through the decades, they kind of slowly moved back to the east and reclaimed some of these areas that they used to be in. And that includes North Dakota. So the population we have, it rebounded naturally. It came back on its own. By about the year 2000, that's when it was kind of obvious or apparent that we had a breeding population in the state, again, out in the Badlands. And the first harvest season took place in 2005 and 2006 with a pretty small quota, and it's continued ever since. Currently, it's under a zone strategy as far as the harvest is concerned. So zone one is, let's see, this area here, and it encompasses all of the suitable habitat, essentially. That's where we have the mountain lion population. The stuff outside of that, including us up here, this is all zone two, and that area has no harvest quota. It still has a season, but there's no quota. And that's just because any lion that occurs out here has essentially removed itself from the population, and so it's kind of on its own at that point. Okay, so you have this population of a top-level predator that has come back relatively recently, right, within the last few decades. And on top of that, you have the bakken. So that combination makes for a pretty interesting scenario, if you will. You know, and there were some questions involved. What kind of impacts are these guys having on the wildlife out there? The elk, the bighorn sheep, the deer, the turkeys, etc. And of course, also the livestock. There's cattle grazing all throughout the Badlands. We've got sheep, goats, horses, etc. So trying to have an understanding of how these lions were impacting these species is obviously important. But on the flip side, we wanted to know too, what kind of impact were we having on the lions themselves? Between the energy development, the traffic, the road network, all of these things, as well as the hunting season, depredation, how were we impacting them? So it led to some pretty distinct research needs, and the state decided to address these starting way back in 2011. The North Dakota Game and Fish Department teamed up with South Dakota State University. They got a grad student, his name was Dave Wilkins, and he came up here for the first 3 years of the project. I call it phase one. And his job was essentially to get some baseline information. This was the first time the population ever had been studied. So a lot of this stuff was more speculation than anything as far as what was going on out there. Get some initial survival estimates, home range estimates, movement patterns, you know, how far were these things traveling? And then the big one was food habits. Trying to get an idea of what lions were eating and how often they were eating it. Now, I'm not gonna talk about this stuff just because I don't have time, but if anybody is interested, I can get you hooked up with his thesis. He's got a 100-page paper covering all of his results. But I picked up in 2014 for phase two. So that's what I'm gonna talk about. And my objectives were essentially to build upon and expand on what he started in phase one. So we wanted to add a couple of years of data to try and get a little bit more improved estimates of survival, more improved estimates of the home range, the movement, those types of things. But also we wanted to check out resource selection. And that means what type of habitats were lions using, which ones were they in, and which ones were they avoiding? Those types of questions. And then finally, my third objective was, I call it a synthesis objective. We wanted to wrap up all this information we've gathered over the last 5 years and produce two things. A habitat suitability map for the whole state, as well as a population model. And these two things are the cornerstone of management going forward in the state. So we'll go through this a little bit. Mountain lions are very, very hard to study. They're very elusive. They live in some pretty rough places, and there's a low density of them, right? So to get this information, the only way you can really do it is you have to capture lions and put collars on them, okay? Now, a lot of the western states rely primarily on hounds to do this type of work. They'll go out and cut a track in the snow, release the hounds, they'll tree the cat, dart it, do their thing, and that works good for them. It doesn't really work as good for us for a couple of reasons. The big one is the trees are different in the Badlands. We've got junipers and cedars that may be as tall as this roof, that's about it. So we don't have the 80-foot ponderosa pines of the Black Hills in Wyoming. So most of the time, those lions up there, when they're bayed by hounds, they go in a hole in the ground. They'll find a little crevice or a little cave, and you can go in and dart them that way. It can work. People have done it. It's just much more difficult. So we chose a different route, and that was to essentially place baits and trap them. So my job, first job, was to collect all kinds of roadkill deer, which was a lot of fun. Pick them up as often as I could find them, and then go out and essentially scout areas for any kind of mountain lion sign, tracks, pictures, whatever, you know, speculate on good areas and place these baits. We monitor everything with trail cameras, and then my technician and I, we would try to check these things at least every 3 days or so. With the idea being that if a lion finds the bait, hopefully he eats the bait, and it will take him 3 or 4 days to finish it. And if you can kind of get in there in the in-between period, then set your trap, then catch him. For the most part, I only set traps once I had a lion actively on a bait. And that's just kind of a safety thing. So, this is a picture of the typical bait site. This is kind of what they look like. You can see the deer kind of in the middle, and essentially what it is, it's a cubby set. But the idea being that you block off all the ways in and you leave just one way in and one way out, right there. And that star, that's where the trap would go, okay? You'll notice a few things. The tree, so the trap is anchored to this tree with a cable, okay? And you'll notice all the limbs are cleared here, all of the limbs and brush is cleared with like a 10-foot circle all the way around that tree. And all that brush is then piled up to make those walls, if you will. So again, there's one way in. And when that lion comes, you can direct their feet pretty well, and they'll put their foot right in the trap, and it works very well. And then once they're caught, it's a pretty safe method. All that brush is loose, so it all gets knocked out of the way. We had lots of swivels on these things. We had shock springs. Everything we could do to ensure that animal was safe and not getting injured. Because you don't want to collar a lion with a broken foot, right? That defeats the purpose. So not only was this safe, we had very little injury. And actually, that picture, I included it because, surprisingly, they actually spent a lot of time just sitting there when they were trapped. We monitored these things so that when one would get caught, we would be there usually within 2 hours. Okay, so they weren't in the trap very long. And like I said, a lot of that time, a lot of that time was spent just sitting there like that. Not very happy, but sitting there waiting for something to happen. So now I have a video to show you what this actually looks like. But before I hit play, I'll just kind of set it up. This is that same bait site I just showed you, just from the camera's view. So that's the camera right there, so we're looking out. Just want to show you what it looks like and kind of how they react. So there's the lion coming in from the right-hand side. You'll see he's nervous. He can smell me for sure. You know, there was a person there. Things have been moved a little bit. The trap sits right here. And you can see there's some sticks and things there to guide his foot. He actually will even smell them before he places his paw. Right there. So obviously he's surprised. He did not expect that. But I do want to point out he's not in pain, if you will. He's not trying to chew his foot off or anything like that. He's obviously surprised. He's frustrated that he's caught. But like I said, they actually spent a large amount of time just sitting there trying to, I think they were trying to think about how am I going to get out of here, essentially. You know, they did fight a little bit. I'm not trying to say they just laid there the whole time. But for the most part, they were more frustrated about being held somewhere than anything. And like I said, within about 2 hours, we were usually there to get them out. So once we caught one, we got in there. We used chemical mobilization to dart the animal. It usually is asleep within 3 or 4 minutes. We pull it out of the trap, and we would do everything we needed to do. We fed him with a GPS collar. Everybody got a unique ear tag. We would weigh them, we would sex them, we would estimate their age. We'd collect a bunch of body measurements. We'd look for injuries, we'd look for parasites. If it was a female, we'd look and see if she was nursing, all these things. If I had time, I would extract a premolar tooth, which is a real small tooth right behind one of the large canines that they really don't even need. In fact, most of them, well, about half don't even have them. It's just a real small vestigial tooth. But extracting that tooth allowed me to get an accurate age. We send it to the lab and then they count the rings on the tooth. I guess the point is most of these animals I never saw again. You have them in your hands once. And your whole study's based on this. So you want to get as much information off of this animal in this short window of about an hour as you possibly can. Once we were done with what we needed to do, then I would give it the reversal drug. We'd step back and watch the thing wake up. The whole thing, like I said, took 60 minutes, sometimes an hour and a half. And this was all approved by the IFP committee as well. Okay, so like I said, I'm not gonna go too much into the stats of this stuff, but essentially, we had a lot of data, not only from my project, but from the project before. And I kind of lumped it all together to get as much out of it as we could. So I estimated annual survival. That just means the chance that an individual lion survives from this year to next year, essentially. Home range sizes, checked out the resource selection. The simplest way to describe this is you compare the habitat attributes of these used locations where lions were, the ones we collected on collars, to the same attributes of random locations that are generated in that same home range. By doing that, you can get an idea and actually quantify the degree of selection for things, the degree of avoidance of things, and you put numbers on that. And then using those numbers, that's how I made the habitat suitability map. So essentially, if there was, this is the list of habitat attributes. I don't know if you can read it or not, but land cover, aspect, so that's northeast, southwest, disturbance, landscape ruggedness, elevation, slope, and then I use distance to water and distance to edge. Edge is essentially the boundary of forest, where one habitat changes to another. That's edge. And these are all things that have been shown to be important to lions in other studies, and things that I suspected would be important as well. But like I said, once we got these results, then I had numbers that I could apply to those variables and essentially score things. So if a lion was using something heavily, it got a higher score. If it didn't like something, it got a lower score. And by doing that, that's how I made the map. And then finally, the population model. It's a pretty statistically heavy technique. It's called statistical population reconstruction. There's a program that helps immensely. But the idea with it is every lion here that's harvested or killed is turned into the state and it's aged. Okay? So you have all of this information with yearly harvest and ages. You can use that data along with some other inputs like survival probabilities, harvest probabilities, hunter effort, those types of things. And it back calculates historical abundance based on what was harvested this year. So if I'm a 5-year-old cat that was harvested here, that means I was in the population this year, and this year, and this year, and this year, going backwards. And all that, of course, depends on the chances of surviving as well. Okay, so finally some results. During my 2 years up here, I captured 9 mountain lions. 4 were adults, 3 were subadults, and 2 were kittens. 7 of them got collared, they all got ear tags. The 2 kittens didn't get a collar because they weren't large enough. They were like 60-pound kittens, they were pretty large, but they weren't quite large enough for the collars we had. And then another cool thing, this one right here, you can see a little ear tag right here. She was marked during the previous phase of research, way back in 2012, I think she was marked. So I got pictures of her repeatedly. I tried to catch her, unfortunately I never did. But I was able to include her in some of these analyses, and it's kind of cool just anecdotally too, because she's at least 8 or 9 years old. So she's lived out there quite a while. And like I said, I joined my data with a good bit of data from phase 1, 16 more cats. So here's some results. So average annual survival on the left over here, calculated from 21 different mountain lions over a 5-year period. So again, this is the chance that an individual lion lives to next year, essentially. 61.3%, that was the average over these 5 years. That number is not terribly high, it's fairly low, and I'll talk a little bit more on that later. And you can see there's some error, you know, things do change year to year, of course, but again, that's an average value. In the analysis, there's 2 variables that came out to be the most important or most influential, if you will, and that is the late hunting season and the sex of the animal. So both of these things actually make sense. If you're a hunter and you're going out there and you cut a track, you're going to favor the bigger tracks. Those are usually the males. Those are usually selected for if you have a choice, and that helps, you know, drop the male survival. On top of that, males move more during the course of a day and a week. They leave more tracks on the ground. They're easier to be found that way. So that's 2 reasons. Males also have lower natural survival too, just because of their tendencies. You know, when they're teenagers, they get in trouble and that doesn't help their chances of surviving at all. On the flip side, the females had much better survival, almost twice as high. Part of that was due to this past year, there was a regulation change with a female sub quota, which means that essentially people were trying to avoid harvesting the females. And I think we saw that a little bit, and it helped bring that number up a little bit, which was the intention of the change in regulation. In the late hunting season, this just refers to the time of the year when hounds are allowed to harvest. Okay, using hounds to pursue mountain lions and harvest them is by far the most effective method there is for taking mountain lions. And that's reflected here. During that month or so when hounds are allowed, that's when a lot of the harvest takes place. Okay, shifting gears to the home ranges, they cover a lot of ground. Males were averaging about 114 square miles, females roughly half that, 50 square miles. So this is the amount of ground they cover in a year. That's their territory, if you will. As large as that is, it's actually on the lower end of other studies across the country. And that's a reflection of good habitat. There's enough prey, there's enough to cover, those types of things that they don't need to necessarily range farther. For example, some of the studies down in the Southwest, like Arizona or those places where it's more desert habitat, they can easily range twice as far in a year. So that's an indication that we do have good habitat up here. Another thing that was kind of cool that became apparent was that the winter home ranges were smaller than the same home range during the summer. And that does make sense too. You have snow on the ground, prey is not moving as much or as far, and it's easier just to stay put and stay warm out there. Okay, so this is the results of the resource selection. What types of habitats do they like? Which ones do they not like? This is a pretty simplified version of it. But for the most part, on a population level, we saw nearly universal selection for the distance to edge variable, the ruggedness variable, and the forest. So what that means is that lions liked to be in these rugged areas with lots of complex terrain, lots of broken features, of course the forest, and then distance to edge. So again, that's where forest changes to grass or vice versa, those types of things. And it all relates back to their hunting style, right? Mountain lions are a stalk and ambush predator. In order to launch a successful attack, they have to be within, from me to the wall, usually, about 20 meters or so. And that's the type of landscape that enables them to do that, right? I like to say you can't stalk up on a deer if you're on a pool table, right? That's what that relates back to. And then, of course, once they do have a kill, these types of features allow them to drag it off and have a little bit of security to feed on it, to raise their young, those types of things. And on the flip side, we saw most of the cats pretty solidly avoiding the disturbance variable. They were avoiding these developed areas, the hay, the crops, pretty much anything that had to do with humans. They wanted to stay away from them the best they could. These other variables on the population level really didn't have much influence. The aspect, elevation, distance to water. We did see actually a pretty interesting response to aspect between the winter and summer seasons. They spent more time overall on the south-facing aspects during the winter time than they did during the summertime. They kind of switched from south in the winter and back to the north in the summer. And again, that makes sense. That comes back to where the sun is, where the warmth is, where the shade is, those types of things. But it was cool to pick up on that with the analysis. So that's a visualization. Rugged terrain, very broken, little human influence, forest, but lots of edge, lots of little nooks and crannies, those types of things. Not only is that where the prey is, but it enables them to get up to one. That's what they were liking. And then, like I said, I used those values, those scores, to rank habitat based on the individual characteristics of the site. Okay, so this is the result of the habitat suitability map. It's a little bit hard to pick out, I know, it looks better on a piece of paper, but the purple is excellent quality, the green is good quality. Okay, so you can see the green pretty well. Most of the purple is right in through here, and there's not a lot of it. That's actually one of the points of this, is that the majority of the state is not suitable for lions. And when I say that, this is based off of resident adult mountain lions, ones that were established, they were breeding. So that means this is the suitable habitat for those same types of cats. This is not meant to represent where a dispersing lion would go. You know, I mean, a dispersing lion can show up about anywhere. They have and they will occasionally. You know, it's still rare. But this is the type of habitat that's available for resident breeding lions. Okay. The tan stuff, this is essentially marginal habitat, is kind of how I classified it. A lot of it occurs out here, and that just, it's areas that a lion can use for a day or two or something like that, but eventually they're going to feel more comfortable getting back to that better quality habitat. So these are like, you know, grass valleys or something like that. Something where a lion can use it, can hide under a bush for a day, but they just want to get back out of there. And finally, the white is unsuitable, and the red, of course, those are the cities and things, that's the highly unsuitable. So the takeaway message here, again, is that most of it's in the Badlands, but we do see some up here in the Turtle Mountains, we see some in the Feminine Gorge, we see some along the Missouri River down towards Bismarck, I believe that's the Knife River, if I'm not mistaken. There are patches, okay? Usually they're near the rivers, and that's kind of expected, right? If we zoom in to the Badlands, there's a few other things to point out. So this is the interstate. Most of the suitable habitat is north of the interstate. There is some down here. There's even some purple mixed in here. Excellent quality stuff. But the vast majority is north. When you go south of the interstate, the habitat turns into more rolling hill stuff. It's still forested, but more spread out, more patchy. It's just not quite as favorable, and that's reflected in the map here. The opposite is true. The farther you go north, things become more rugged, more forested, more broken. And again, that's reflected here. Most of this purple stuff is all up here in the northern Badlands, okay? And this is actually, it corroborates really well with where we find most of the harvested lions. Most harvested lions are killed between about Grassy Butte in this area and up through Killdeer over here, the northern Badlands. And it's actually reflected quite well in the map here. If you go south of the interstate, the odds of finding a lion down there are very, very low. But again, this is where we have breeding lions, or this isn't meant to map where we have breeding lions, it's habitat. So this habitat may or may not be full or occupied. And then, of course, you can have a dispersing lion show up just about anywhere. And that's what a lot of this other stuff over here represents. If there's a lion that takes off, you know, they might use these little patches, if they can find them, to help facilitate the dispersal movement, you know, going to whatever their final destination may be. Okay, since I'm up here, I wanted to talk about the Turtle Mountains. This was one of the questions we tried to answer was, whether or not the Turtle Mountains had sufficient habitat to support its own population of lions. The short answer is no. Based on the quantity of suitable habitat, we just don't quite find enough here. So this number, about 269 square kilometers, that includes some of the Canadian side. I didn't map the Canadian side, but I tried to extrapolate. I think it was about 50% or maybe not even quite that much. I just tried to include the other side. Now, you guys obviously know better than I do, but I think the Canadian side is a little bit more remote, a little bit more rugged, so that number could go up a little bit, okay? That's true, but it still falls well short of the 1,000 square kilometers that previous research has shown. You need that much space for a self-sustaining population. A population that can reproduce itself and keep going for, you know, into the future. So based on that, again, the Turtle Mountains seems unlikely to support lions, but, and this is where it gets interesting, Nebraska is in a similar position with North Dakota. They have lions coming back, and they actually have three distinct subpopulations right now, and they've documented breeding females in these areas, and these areas are actually smaller than the Turtle Mountains. The main difference is all of these arrows. These populations are closer together. They're closer to the big source populations in Wyoming and Colorado, the Black Hills. So there's much more connectedness between them, which allows them to essentially move back and forth between them. And they're not restricted to just one little island. Up here, the distance between the Turtle Mountains and the Badlands is farther. The habitat isn't quite as suitable for a lion to move back and forth between it. You know, here the Niobrara River, they've got some pretty decent corridors, if you will, to move between them. We don't really have that up here. We've documented four lions in the Turtle Mountains over the years. That's the best I can find anyway. So they have occurred, and again, those are dispersing cats. They show up one day, they're gone the next. But as far as the chances of the Turtle Mountains being recolonized at this point in time by its own distinct population is very low. Perhaps changes in regulation one day maybe would allow more connectivity between the two, and maybe, you know, there is some habitat here that could support lions, but the connectivity is just not there right now. So with that, it still remains very unlikely that they'll take up residence here in the Turtle Mountains again. Residence, again, not necessarily saying that they can't show up one day and then go out the next. That can and probably still will be happening. Okay, results of the population model. Essentially, the takeaway message here is that it went up and now it's going down. Okay, I do want to point out there's a lot of error bars here. There's a lot of variability in these numbers. So I don't want to get hung up on the actual number, the estimate of abundance, because for the most part, the number of lions is very hard to come up with. And it doesn't necessarily mean as much as the trend. Is the population going up? Is it going down? Or is it staying about the same? Okay. That said, it peaked up here in 2011 and 12, around 165 lions. That's what the model estimates. That includes adults, subadults, and kittens, so everybody. Okay. The low was back in the first year, about 27. The average across the years is 71, so kind of right there. But again, we see quite a bit of variability between years and within years as well. Currently, it's estimating about 40 lions. And my experience out there, I actually tend to agree with that. I always thought, you know, the amount of ground I covered, the amount of ground my predecessor Dave covered during these years, we had lots and lots of baits up, we had lots and lots of cameras out, we were out there every day, and, you know, I think I probably had eyes on maybe 20 cats throughout the course of the study, and he had a few more than that. He also had more abundance going on, too. But those numbers, I tend to agree with those numbers based on what I saw out there, okay? But that said, the population model had a lot of variability in it. It's not perfect. There is no perfect model, right? But it's a good tool. No matter which way you slice it, right now the population is going down. But you can also see that it does show signs of actually leveling off a little bit too. So it'll be interesting going forward to see how it continues, if it maintains around this 50 number or where we go from here. Okay, so some discussions of this. What does all this mean? North Dakota certainly has sufficient habitat for a small population. It will never be as large as Colorado or Montana or the Black Hills, it's just not there. That said, we do have good quality habitat. We have lots of this rugged forested stuff. The highest quality stuff is in the northern Badlands, and that has implications for density of lions. You know, there's probably more lions in those areas, and that has impacts on the livestock producers in that area, as well as the wildlife in that area. So it's good to have a handle on that, as well as now we can actually quantify the amount of suitable habitat, and then we can speculate further on carrying capacity based on densities and those types of things. Another thing to take away is the energy development out there. I call it, the impacts are more indirect than direct. Physically, having an oil well out in the Badlands doesn't seem to really affect the lions much at all. They still use areas right next to them. They cross the roads all the time. The physical infrastructure is not the problem. It doesn't hurt them that much. But the indirect effects, the traffic, changing the distribution of the prey, all those roads, of course, that opens it up to folks out there hunting them. They've got tracks easier, those types of things. That's what we're seeing from that. And of course, there's not much you can do about it, but it's nice to have that at least analyzed a little bit and have a better idea of what is going on. The other message is the population is going down. The model shows that. Our survival estimates show that. Generally speaking, most folks agree you need at least 65% annual survival across a population to be the same this year as next year, to flatline. okay? We're below that, we've been below that for some time, and like I said, that agrees with the model, that it is going down. Most of that mortality is human-induced, between the legal hunting season, of course, but also the occasional roadkill, depredation, poaching, catching them in snares by accident, those types of things. So most of the mortality is human-induced. So there's certainly things to look at there. And that's kind of where the state will go next. Hopefully, I recommend they revisit their hunting season structure. You know, consider changes perhaps, and as well as revisiting the quota, and then continue to refine this population model. I think it's a very good tool. But like I said, some of the inputs need to be refined and keep adding to this year after year after year. It'll be a good tool for them going forward. Regardless, they now have the information they need to make some scientifically informed decisions. We know a heck of a lot more now than we did 5 years ago about these lions. So much less speculation and much more evidence and observations. Okay, so that's kind of part one. Anybody have any questions on that stuff? Next, I'm going to go into recreating the lion country. Okay, we can come back to it if they had anything. So basically, the question is, if you're out there in the Badlands, and there's mountain lions out there, some people are fearful, some people aren't even aware they're out there. There's all kinds of responses to being in mountain lion country. The question is, can we coexist? The short answer is yes, we can. In fact, I documented time and time again that we're already coexisting out there. Lions aren't causing much trouble to the recreators. Walking down the same trails as we are, doing it during the daylight hours, obviously not right at the same time, but this was one of the busiest trails I had a camera on. I had people driving down it, taking horses down it, walking down it, hunting down it. They were down it all the time. And I got all kinds of pictures of lions using that same trail. And I don't think any of these folks were any of the wiser. Okay, so these lions are already out there. They've been out there, and they're causing very little impact as far as recreation is concerned. This one's cool because if anybody's been out to the Elkhorn Ranch, this is the fence of the west border. So the trees and stuff is Teddy Roosevelt's old ranch there. And in this cat, again, walking down the trail, this was August 23rd at 7 p.m. So you or I or anybody could have been walking down that trail at the same time too. So again, they're out there, they're using the same areas, but I'm not trying to scare anybody either. The chances of a lion attack on a person are incredibly, incredibly low. To date, there's been none recorded on people in North Dakota or South Dakota. In fact, across all of North America, during this time period, well over 100 years, 80 reported lion attacks on people, 20 of which were fatal, 70% of those fatalities were kids, okay? Now, of course, this is nothing to joke about. It's not good. It does happen, it has happened, it will continue to happen, unfortunately. But the point is, the odds of this occurring are so remote. You probably have a better chance of getting stung by a bee and having an anaphylactic reaction than being attacked by a mountain lion. So I just want to put that into perspective a little bit and try to get away from the notion that these lions are bloodthirsty and they're out there to attack. That's not really the case, okay? And now I have a few, there we go. So these guys actually spend the majority of their time just being cats, okay? They do hunt, they're very effective predators. They can kill pretty much on demand. They know what they're doing. But that represents a small portion of their life. The rest of the time, they're laying around, hanging out, scratching. Their mannerisms are very, very similar to your house cat. Okay? So this is a more accurate representation of the daily life of a mountain lion. Okay? They like to hang out in the sun, sit under the trees, stay warm, these types of things. They're very playful and curious. See this one playing with a stick, rolling around. This one's got a CD here it's on a bait site, but I used to hang CDs and feathers to try and get their attention. And they would play with them, they would run around. This was kind of funny, I got like 3 pictures in a row of the lion just running around in circles. So they're not vicious killers. They're not cuddly animals either. They're somewhere in between, okay? When we hear about mountain lions, we generally right away think of danger and fear and those things, but that's not necessarily the case. You don't have to be afraid of them. You have to respect them, but you don't have to be afraid of them. Most of the problems lions cause are by the young, the old, the sick, and the injured. This is the case with a lot of these predators, right? If you're young, you're learning how to hunt, or if you're old and your teeth are worn out, you know, or maybe you're injured, you gotta go for the easy things. And those are the ones that tend to get themselves in trouble, okay? Or, on the flip side, the kids and the pets. Again, the easy targets. Those are kind of the ones that are most susceptible to these problems. For the most part, lions want nothing to do with people. All the time I spent out there, I only ever saw one actually in the wild, if you will. All the rest were in traps. And I had occasions where I'd hang up a camera, leave, come back in a week and check it. The very first picture is a lion. Just curious, he followed me down there. I never knew it. He'd sniff the camera, sniff around, see what's going on, and then he'd leave. So again, you're coexisting while you're out there. If you spend any amount of time in the Badlands, sooner or later you're probably going to pass a lion, probably not be any wiser. Now this is another video that I think is cool because it shows, I think, a more typical behavior. So this lion's eating on a bait site, it's actively feeding, middle of the night, this is on a trail camera, and something catches its attention. And I have no idea what it was, but it immediately comes to attention. You can see its ears are forward, it's staring, it's very alert to whatever this thing is. And then you'll see how he reacts. Again, it's not aggression, it's not anything like that. He essentially, I'll let you watch, I'll give it away. He tries to ignore it, but he can't. And he actually leaves, but not only does he leave, he sneaks away. He tiptoes out of there as quietly as he can. Now, like I said, I don't know what caused him to do that, but obviously something. And I think that's a more typical reaction. If you're hiking down a trail or something and you happen to pass by a lion, they're not going to jump out and scare you or anything like that. They're going to just either stay put or try to sneak away just like you. I think that's a much more typical representation of their behavior. That said, the chances of running into a lion are possible. Negative encounters are certainly possible, so it's still good to know what to do in that case. Okay? The biggest two, I think, are to try and hike in groups, right? More people the better. And probably the biggest one, don't let the kids and the pets get way out in front, don't let them fall behind, those types of things. Because again, as you showed, those are kind of the easy targets that the ones that are going to cause a problem are going to go for. Okay? And again, those things are pretty easy to control for the most part. Try to avoid being out there at dawn, dusk, and night. That's when they're most active. That one I have a hard time with because that's when I'm most active too. During the heat of the day, I'm usually not trying to hike too much. But make some noise, that's usually pretty easy to do. And carry just a walking stick, you know, especially if you're nervous about this stuff. But, you know, you can kind of cater this to your own personal preference. If you're not scared about it, don't worry about it, you're probably going to be fine. If you are really nervous, these things you can do to minimize even further that really, really remote risk. If it actually comes down to being an aggressive lion, one that you think might come after you, you can fight it off. First of all, the big thing is don't panic. Let it know you're not prey. Stand tall, throw rocks, you can yell, whatever you gotta do to let it know that you're not an easy target, right? And then also, give it an escape route. Sometimes, if you come around a bend or something and there's a lion walking on that same trail you are, it'll be just as surprised as you are, and it wants to get out of there just as bad as you do, and it may or may not turn around, but it might try to go by you or past you, if you can just kind of make sure it has a way out of there. Same idea, don't corner an animal, right? Same idea here. And if it does come to it, and it does actually come after you, again, be big, be strong, yell, and fight back with everything you have. People have been attacked and fought them off and been just okay. So it's always good to have in the back of your head while you're out there. But again, the chances are really low. And most of this stuff can be prevented, right? Have some respect. Understand these animals understand their capabilities, but also don't necessarily fear them, right? You don't have to be afraid of them. They're going to leave you alone just as bad as you want to leave them alone. Be aware of your surroundings and prevent these things too. Like I said, you can carry a stick, a walking stick, which a lot of folks do anyway. Try to stay in groups. Don't let the kids weigh out, the pets weigh out, those types of things. And if you're interested in more of this stuff, North Dakota Game and Fish puts out a really good brochure. That's the front picture. They have all this type of stuff. They also have lots of information on what tracks look like, the sign, those types of things. You can get more info there. These are the acknowledgments. Lots and lots of people to thank. All the state agencies, all the federal agencies up here, everybody was tremendous in this effort. Lots of landowners, technicians, previous grad student, my advisor, John Jenks, Stephanie Tucker of Game and Fish, Dan Grove. Lots of people to thank. Thank you. Any questions? That was another very interesting reaction I saw all the time. Skunks were very bold, trying to defend their, well, my baits from these lions. And the lions were pretty bold back, but they usually won the fight. They hiss and then run away. So does anybody have any questions? Yes, sir.
So when you were showing us that chart and it looked like 212 to 213, there was a big drop.
Yes.
Did you, what were your reasons why you thought that happened? Was there a lot more harvested that year? Was there a disease or what?
That's a good question. Actually, that year, I'll give that to it right there. Part of this is too, the big variability here. You know, that's part of it. But there was a definite drop there, and most of it was out of season mortalities. The hunting season really didn't change much between here and here. The harvests, the legal harvests stayed the same, but there was a lot of depredation that year. There was a lot of legal stuff going on those years, road kills those years, those types of things. So in effect, the total mortalities were like doubled in those years. And since it's dropped down here, now we're seeing just one or two road kills a year, much fewer depredation calls, all those types of things. Now the population has dropped down. Yes, sir.
The ranchers that I've talked to in that area absolutely hate everyone I've talked to.
Yep.
And they kind of have the idea, if you see one, shoot it, shove it, shut up.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, though, in your studies, what is the amount of depredation to livestock that you actually see that can be attributed to lions?
Yes, that's a really good question. And that was, like I said, that was a big focus of phase one. It was one of the first things they wanted to figure out, how much is actually going on. So the fellow up here before me, for 2.5 years, he had, I think, 16 different lions collared, okay? His job, every time one of them made a kill, it would sit there and feed for like 3 days, and all those locations would cluster. As soon as that happened, he would go in there and find out what did it kill, and what is it eating. I think he checked out 500 kills in that neighborhood, and only one of those cats ever killed livestock. All of the rest of them were mule deer, primarily, some whitetail, a few elk, turkeys, porcupines, raccoons, you know, things like that, but the vast majority were the deer. That one lion did kill calves. I think it killed two or three before they went ahead and then they removed it. Wildlife Services took it out. But based on that, as well as mine, I checked out, I think, like 36 just for my own sake, just checking them out. And again, deer, porcupine, turkeys, all those things. I didn't have any problems with livestock with my cats either. So based on that, there's much less depredation going on out there than what's perceived. In fact, to add to that, there's another fellow doing a big study on mule deer right now. He's kind of finishing up, but he had over 100 mule deer collared throughout the Badlands. And all the ones that died, I think 5 were from mountain lions. More were killed by coyotes in his study. So again, all the evidence we have is indicating that while it does happen, we know it happens, it's happening much less than what it's perceived as. It's kind of an easy excuse, really, in a lot of cases.
Your habitat's up in the Turtle Mountains. Is there a connection over to like northern Minnesota, northwest angle? Is there habitat that direction? Or are we kind of on the tail end of the Rockies?
Yeah, it's more connected to the west.
Okay.
We've documented cats coming in from Montana. Two of them came in from the Charles Russell refuge, they call it, a couple out there. It's quite a distance, obviously, to get to Minnesota. But that said, I didn't have any cats take off, but there's been, in the past, ones on the Black Hills that have taken off, and they've covered, I have a slide or a picture in another presentation, but it shows all these different locations across the state. They've popped up just about anywhere in the state. Okay, but all those cats are generally moving to the east, and they just disappear. They get hit on the road, or somebody shoots them, all those things. So there's basically nothing coming from the east. Okay. There is some study out there that they have done something similar in Minnesota and the Great Lakes regions, and they've shown that they can support lions there if they would ever get there. But there's just, it's too hard to get there at this point. Everybody that tries usually dies.
Did you collect DNA samples then as well, and does that compare like with what game fish does for harvest?
Yes.
So that they can tell whether we got one big expanded family or we got multiple different families? Or?
Yep. So I collected the DNA sample, but through the ear punch, I had a little put in the jar. So actually a study was just done with, I think, over 100 carcasses from North Dakota, a bunch from South Dakota, and Montana, I think, and Wyoming. And it showed that we have a distinct population here. It's genetically different, enough that we can tell the difference. I guess that's the point. And they've documented North Dakota cats in South Dakota. They've documented them leaving that way. We've also documented South Dakota cats here as well through that stuff. Overall, the genetic health is good. They're healthy, they're not inbreeding or anything like that yet. So even though the population is low, they're still healthy. But if it remains low for the next 20 years, there may be questions there. But on the flip side of that, even one or two lions immigrating in can really keep up the genetic health of the population.
You said you were making recommendations to Game and Fish for quotas and stuff like that. Do you have information on what they've had? You know, we had high years, of course, they probably had higher quotas back then.
Well, actually, the quota has changed not a heck of a lot. It has tracked a little bit. Back here, it was 5 animals. They filled it. I think it went to 8 for a while, it went to 10 for a while, and then it was at like 21. 21, 21, 21, 21. This year, it actually came down to 15. So they did lower it a little bit. It's a little bit tricky because the quota is split between the early season and the late season, right? They always fill the late season quota because of the dogs, the hounds. And that's what we showed with the survival estimates. It's the early season stuff that's all opportunistic. So when there's more lions out there, obviously opportunistic, you're going to take one. That number has dropped from like a dozen now down to just 4. Well, I think there was 5 this year, maybe 6. So it's coming down a little bit. There's still a lot of people out there, you know, still seeing them. So as far as what the recommendation should be for a quota, that's above my pay grade. That's the boss's job. And she has an idea of what she wants to do, but I think a good discussion needs to take place about how many lines do we want, you know? That's a good question and a good discussion to have.
Do you think some of the deprivation that does occur, like you said, coyotes are more doing it? Are the mountain lions getting blamed just because they're meaner looking?
I think it's part of it. Yeah, like I said, when you think of a mountain lion, right away you think of them snarling and biting and that stuff. It's just not the case for the most part. They can kill livestock. They will kill livestock, and they do. We've documented that they do. But we've documented a heck of a lot more that they don't. And that's consistent across the country, too. Oftentimes, the same cats that are going to attack a person are the ones that get in trouble with livestock, too. The old and the sick and the injured and those types of things. So. Any other questions?
Anymore? You have something coming?
I was just going to ask if anybody's had any activity in the Turtle Mountains. I'm always curious. I know there's trail cameras everywhere. Has anybody ever gotten a picture of one? Because if you do, Game and Fish wants to know.
Tracks.
Yeah. If you have pictures of them, send them to the Game and Fish Department because we've got 4 of them documented. But it's really interesting right now with the way Nebraska is, the way this is. Obviously, if it's occurring, you'd like to know. Oh, you said you have a track. Yes.
Documented. What does that mean?
So a verified report is a picture, or a track, or a carcass, or a roadkill, something like that. That's what a documented You know, there's a lot of reports that come in and they turn out to be a bobcat or a dog or a house cat. Those are unfounded. So the actual number of reports up here, I have no idea. It's much higher than four.
How long does a colored cat have to be in an area before they accept it as its own territory?
It's a good question. So they usually leave their mom about 15 months, year and a half-ish. They take off. The females usually will stick around closer to home, and they can have a territory established even by the time they're two or two and a half, three. The males usually will take off. They cover farther distances. And I think it takes a good half of a year, 6 months or so, before they really determine, is this spot even open? Am I going to get killed? Is there enough to support me here? And is there any females here? Those are the questions they
have. So if you had a colored cat in that area, though, how long would it have to stick around to be, like,
considered a resident?
Yeah.
So, like, I had young cats that were dispersing all throughout the study, so I didn't include them in much of this stuff. I think it was 4 months I considered them a resident. If they were in the same area consistently for 4 months, I considered them a resident.
Okay.
Yeah. I hope that answers some questions. Maybe calm a few fears, if you will. I know I've got relatives that like to hike and stuff, but everybody's nervous about mountain lions in the hills and don't necessarily have to.
Okay, let's give Andy a big hand.